the time I get this up, Gamescom in Cologne has been over for about a month. Battlefield 1 had a flashy demo of a desert map with battle trains, horses, biplanes, all the cool explosions you can take in one day, and all of it now playable in the beta and now available in Origin. The proposed dehumanizing trench warfare, traumatic gas attack, and slow death from gangrene game modes were sadly lacking from the week's exhibition, however. The most exciting thing I saw out of the con, however, was the hour and a half long demonstration for Star Citizen. Maybe exciting is the wrong word to use. Interesting may be more appropriate. The most common point of discussion I hear about the game is whether it's vaporware or not. Lofty on-paper promises, proof of concept videos, and early alpha versions aside, we've not seen that much game from one of the biggest fan-funded projects of the 2010s. This demonstration seems to be trying to provide some explanation. Yeah, we're sitting on millions of dollars. Now here's what we're doing with it. This demo was also gratuitously well-timed. Press and gamers alike are just getting over how disappointed they are with No Man's Sky. After playing it for a little while, my impression of it is as a low-key game with simple mechanics that has some cool technical features, very broad color palette, and a disturbing number of devastating bugs, glitches, and generally poor optimization on the PC. The hype surrounding the game built it up to be an industry-redefining titan, even while the developers were simultaneously actively saying it was no such game or promising things to be in the game that never materialized. When people got it out of the box, they were dismayed that it wasn't everything that they dreamed. And that's the problem. They dreamed up a game that never existed, helped in no small part by the whispering of Sony and Hello Games' marketing team. For one reason or another, people really want a new genre-defining space game. Throw a couple of promising but fairly vague and teasing trailers in the mix, a bunch of on-paper promises, and watch people fill in the blanks with their imagination. There's no way Sony was gonna stifle people's hype, not when there's money to be recouped from their other failing divisions. Yes, of course, it's everything you've dreamed of and more. When the game comes out and people are all pissed over the hype machine drawing money out of their pockets for a game which wasn't they expected like it does, time and time again like clockwork, all Sony does is shrug, hey, we never lied to you. Well, maybe we lied to you a little bit, but really it's your fault. The only person who lied to you was you. We just never dampened the fires in the massive engine of the hype machine, that's all, don't blame us. Now, I told you that story to tell you this one. Star Citizen has built a fanatical following, over 1.5 million people who want to believe in a well-made space game, which encompasses all their desires for smooth planet-to-space travel, ship-to-ship combat, shipboarding, role-playing, galactic intrigue, and polygons, polygons, polygons. They want to believe in it to the tune of $120 million. And there is a simultaneous faction which believe that it's all bullshit. A scam, probably. They've been burned by games like Spore, SimCity, No Man's Sky, again and again over the last 5 years, to the point where all the somewhat vague pre-development chatter and storyboarding, and even the early playable versions of the game seem suspicious, almost sinister. I'm sure that this demonstration will be seen by some as ammunition of sorts. See, we were right. It is real. Take that, naysayers. Come to the light, you dumb fucks. Even whether or not the game is going to be good has devolved into tribalism, even before we've even seen a full model of how the game is supposed to function, which is what I think this video is supposed to be. My thoughts while watching through the video were of trying to separate what was a proof of concept and what seemed to be a feature working as intended, what they used in the trailer to try and boost the image of the game, and what was actually there. And I'm taking this demo at face value, not based on any AMAs about what the developers say they're going to do or what's been planned, because that's the same trap as No Man's Sky and SimCity. Don't want to get burned. So let's walk this tightrope that we've all had the good fortune to find ourselves on as consumers together. This demo raises a lot of questions for me, and that is despite the fact that Star Citizen is not following the same hype path that No Man's Sky did. Star Citizen's not playing vague trailers which whisper the world behind an unspoken veil. Star Citizen has very clearly expounded explicit goals, the list of which got longer and longer by the passing month and million. I think they've stopped adding them, but the stretch goals are at this point legion. For each of the features shown in this particular demo, I had either a curiosity or a question which wasn't answered at least by the demo itself. Starting right off with the sleep feature, they are apparently intending to use it as a sort of save system slash checkpoint system. So where you last slept is where you're going to respawn when you die. The two questions I have about this address Star Citizen as an MMO. They showed off the in-station sleeping quarters, and with hundreds of players using the stations as mission and supply hubs, will they get full to the point where you can't use them and you have to find somewhere else to go? Richard said about the other station services like docking, well, if somebody else is docking, you're gonna have to wait, and you're gonna have to wait for the elevators too. Why? Why should I boot up my $1,000 PC and load up a game that took millions of dollars and 3 years to develop in order to wait for a goddamn virtual elevator? Wouldn't single individuals also be able to grind entire systems to a halt just by sitting in the elevator and pushing the down button over and over again? I know for a fact that there are people out there who would find nothing more enjoyable than making a few hundred people wait in line while they single-handedly ruin the economy of an entire solar system by pressing the E button. Let's take this a bit further. I remember EVE Online's core trading systems being bogged down by concurrent player traffic. Jita often had a long wait time while the game's servers loaded people into and out of the system, and God forbid anybody actually start a fight outside the system. Why would you implement a system which intentionally slows down your progress when it could be slow enough because of player traffic? Here's another related question. What's going to happen to your ship when you log off in space? Will it disappear? Again, in EVE Online, if you had a bounty on your head, say, and you walked into a system with some bounty hunters and you didn't want to deal with them, you could just log off and your ship would go to some uncharted part of space and it was possible to scan you down and kill you, but most people didn't have that equipment, so usually if your ship got away in time, it was a get-out-of-jail-free card. Now, the indication is that your ship is a very different entity than the person flying it, so your ship would probably just sit there in space. So what happens when the game crashes? Or the servers go down? Are you just left then with 15 or so minutes of vulnerability while an outside force controls your ability to get back in your ship? As obnoxious as a disappear into unknown space feature is, it's a decent stopgap to external problems taking away your assets. Maybe Citizen will feature something cooler, or maybe it'll just be that your ship just floats in space if you log off without stashing it. I realize that a lot of these questions could probably be answered down the road, and after all, this is mostly a proof of concept demonstration, but with stuff like the elevators, it seems like there's some features being installed on the ground floor that are gonna start affecting other stuff vertically when it comes time to introduce large-scale player interaction. Speaking of proof of concept, most of the demo demonstrated a pretty neat two-player mission, which had a little bit of everything. A little bit of space combat, a little bit of first-person shooter, a little bit of space stations and planets and all that. This looks more of a game. This will be where you'll have to be distinguished. What is meant to be a promised feature, which will be in the game, and what is an implication? Wouldn't it be cool if? For example, the segment where the guys approach the derelict hull of the ship, go EVA, and enter the ship from the outside through its split hull. This is both a dynamic mission location and a ship. It's really goddamn cool, but it also implies that maybe all ships could be dynamically damaged like this, that space battles will finish with large fields of cracked hulls just like this, which are explorable in the interiors, and that scavenging would be more like exploration of a broken ship hulls than waiting for a scanner to hit 100%. We already know that the ship damage model already visually includes everything from scratches on the paint to gashes in the hull exposing wiring and machinery. They mentioned in a blog post last year that it might be possible for the larger ships to have this exact same kind of damage on a larger scale, exposing corridors to space. So far in the alpha, there are ships bigger than just a cockpit with some controls, and you can move around the interiors in their whole different rooms. And the devs say they're going to be capital ships, the interiors of which are like whole levels. There are fighters and medium-class ships in the alpha right now, there will be planetary interaction, and we just saw a demo where a dude spacewalked into a ship from the outside. They mentioned that they would be working on a specific dynamic power routing system inside the ship. Maybe repairs would involve tracing the damage through your ship, finding the explicit section instead of just holding down E and watching your dude tighten an invisible ratchet until the percent bar reaches 100%. That would be revolutionary and pretty cool, and from the look of the demo, it looks like they're leaning that way, but this is not confirmation of any such system, just a very strong suggestion. 1+1=hype, and I want to avoid that. This is a static mission location in the demo. They've not shown off a system where player ship is turned into derelict explorable repairable wreck. Not yet, anyways. The other part of this that was cool was that you saw the two guys split up and accomplish different parts of the same task. The pilot stayed out in the ship and the second guy went into the ship, but during the demo, the pilot player basically played Chewbacca to the other player's Han Solo. parking the ship, waiting with the ship, flying the ship while Han manned the space cannons and drove around in his space chopper. I think this whole scenario is, again, way too optimistic about human nature. There's no way the average gamer is gonna sit in a ship watching the clouds go by while you go in, search a station, have a couple of beers, and talk to a bald guy who seems really preoccupied with his damn Dick Tracy watch. And I don't think that the game is actually gonna have this be the case. I'm just saying the average gamer doesn't wanna be Chewbacca. They wanna be Han Solo. But my guess is that if you're really interested in Star Citizen at this point, you're probably not the average gamer. You're probably an enthusiast. And I don't say that to stroke anyone's ego. You're just watching the bare-bottomed alpha of a fan-funded nerdy space game that probably won't run on just anybody's hardware. Now, I'm game for a bit of light roles in my space role-playing games if I'm not straight up pretending I'm a space captain at the same time. I'm just saying that particularly if this is a scripted-out mission, maybe plan for something both players can do. I know this is a demo for the mechanics themselves, like, hey, you can go from inside your ship to inside their ship, have a shootout, then go straight down from that to the surface of a planet and have a gunfight down there. Just go anywhere. Very cool. That does explain the amount of time Chewie is just waiting outside while Han does all the cool stuff. And it also explains the de-evolution of the demo right at the end. Han and Chewie had just finished the primary part of the mission, but oh, there's a secret second part to steal the cargo the pirate stole and take it for yourself. So they go down to the planet, cue Space Harley, cue speeder fight on the planet's surface, cue ground flight plus ship fight, all very cool. And then suddenly there's two other guys who are trying to get to this treasure. Not AI, two more players. And the space van driver sucks, and there's this really awkward gunfight where there's some objects disappearing and reappearing, and both guys seem to be trying to miss each other, and it seems very obviously choreographed, so the one guy can get shot by the spaceship, and you know what? That part's fine. Again, this is a proof of concept more than anything else. I just think that the way the player versus player mechanics were presented was very awkward and kind of shoehorned in. Now we get to the final part of the demo. Han finds the pirate treasure, picks it up, and carries it physically to the ship while Chewie figures out a good landing position. I've always said that I enjoy the more mundane aspects of sci-fi, probably more than the average person. The whole idea of physically grabbing and hauling cargo onto your ship is actually appealing to me. The presence of mundanity makes the game feel more real. Hey, you could get machines to load the bigger stuff. Maybe these little arc grav loaders, maybe some space forklifts. The forklift dock job from Shenmue was one of my favorite parts of the game. I'd be so down with some space forking. And apparently this is their plan for the cargo system, to have objects be carryable. You can put them in a box, carry that box around, to have your cargo actually in your ship so you can move that cargo around, stack it on top of each other. Hauling cargo from one system to the other might be more than just hitting a buy button to add more cargo to your hull and then flying to another system and hitting the sell button. Buy a box on Nerd Herfers and you gotta go down to the dock to get them and load them into your ship, and it's really cool if it happens. So Han drags his cargo onto the ship, and then all of a sudden, in the most unexpected and organic way, oops, that shady guy with the watch obsession double-crossed you, and that's the end of the demo. Cliffhanger! The entire mission portion raises a question for me about scale. So far, there are supposed to be 100 or so star systems in the game. Roberts also said that Citizen would have a mix of scripted and unscripted missions. What might the balance be? Immersion seems a key factor in Citizen, and while the structure here is very rote, Han and Chewie performed what was ultimately a fetch quest. They went to a ship and got a thing, went to a planet and picked up another thing. It's the proposed scale of Citizen that makes things interesting. They could have found that pirate base's location from low orbit and dropped Han right off in the middle of the base, stayed in the ship and blasted the surface with the cannons, landed on a mountain nearby and sniped down. Hell, maybe orbital bombardment would be an option. A simple mission could be made cooler and more complex with all of these systems interacting, but how many missions are going to have this level of detail? With a mission giver, voice acting, interplay, with a possible overarching storyline, with hundreds of systems and a long story to be considered. And if you're playing with a friend and they're not at the same place in the storyline, would you end up doing story missions over again, like in a lot of co-op shooters? That would kind of break the immersion for me, and it seems like playing with other people is a core part of what makes Citizen cool, so how are they gonna pull that one off? I mean, even with just procedural missions, it could be really cool. With larger ships and later missions, you could grab 30 of your friends and have a massive dogfight around Titanic capital ships in orbit, destroy their shield generators so we can launch our marines at their flagship. They cling to the side with their magnetic boots so they can blow a capacitor to vent a segment of the ship so they can enter, fighting through deck and corridor towards the bridge. The dogfight outside distracting the crew. The Marines sabotage the helm, and the carrier careens into the gravity well of the planet. They were only this close to discourage fighters from approaching from planetside, where they would have to contend with the planet's atmosphere and gravity, but now it means their doom! The captain sounds the alarm, abandon ship, and the crew race to the escape pods, but some don't make it. Boom! Sure, we didn't see any of that in the demonstration, but hell, that's what we were all thinking, right? And that's my point exactly. I just came up with all that crap. Well, not entirely. We know what we've seen on the Robert Space Industries website. We know that capital ships will be huge. We know that interiors will be explorable. We know that there's going to be a dynamic FPS. We just saw a demo with a guy going from inside his ship, doing a spacewalk, entering another ship, and having a gunfight. Really, this scenario writes itself, and I really want it to be real so badly, and that's exactly what hype is. I've already filled in the holes with my imagination. I'm developing a second parallel video game in my head, like I've done time and time again, and this game will never be that game. Being excited for things makes me happy, but I can't say the entire process is entirely enjoyable, especially when the end product comes along and it's not really what I wanted. And I've still got a bunch of questions. We see a barren planet in the demo with the space chopper riding around the surface. Will you be able to do that in city planets? How many land vehicles will there be? Where's the balance between scripted and non-scripted content gonna be like? Will there be space forklifts? Will the co-pilot get to do anything in the second seat, like navigate or increase engine power when he's not shooting the turrets? What is on that damned watch? Will the areas outside space station windows become clogged with players on day one? Will the servers? Citizen is extremely ambitious, probably the opposite of No Man's Sky, and while I don't think Roberts is blowing smoke in our ears, and I really almost desperately hope the game comes to fruition to all my wildest dreams, I still can't assume that what I'm supposed to imagine from Citizen will be exactly what comes out. Citizen is trying something new in a market that seems catered to the old, and I really wish them the absolute best when it comes to making this game. And I also want to make the best choices when it comes to seeing things as they are, not how we want them to be.